Hi, I'm Dominic with Sloan Technical Services Department. In this video, we are going to cover the general maintenance on a standard manual flushometer. And we're going to go over the components and some of the symptoms, as well as the parts to repair it. Part of the video is going to go over not only the components, but the general maintenance and how to install the components. And really all you need is a simple smooth jawed wrench and a screwdriver. If the valve has been around a while, it could be a little bit finicky where we might need something a little more, like maybe a pick to pull an O-ring out or some fine emery cloth. We're going to go over these things a step at a time. Flushometer 101. So the main components of the flushometer are, we have the control stop, the valve body assembly, the handle, the vacuum breaker, flush connection, as well as the spud flange assembly. Beneath this is the spud itself. And the spud is part of the toilet, which we will cover at the end of this segment. So one of the things to remember, it's very important, is the type of tools we're using. Typically, compression wrenches, especially with teeth, are a no-no because you will ruin the chrome finish that we painstakingly take a very great amount of time and care putting these things together after they run through the chroming process to make sure that your valve has a nice smooth chrome polish. One of the important parts about servicing a flushometer is the right tools. And we offer the Sloan A50 wrench, as well as a standard slotted screwdriver, quarter inch, is more than sufficient to work on the flushometer. And the reason being is, we're gonna go over the components and why we use the proper tools. Okay, so here's a few samples of the tools that are used for working on flushometers. We have the plier type wrenches, if you notice. Channel lock. These are smooth jawed, and we have what's referred to as a spud wrench, or this is a smooth jawed pipe wrench, and we have another variation of the smooth jaw pipe wrench. And then there's the one that we offer, that we make, it was designed to work on flushometers, is the Sloan A50. Now these are all fixed facets, so we've got several facets on here for working on all the different couplings that are on a flushometer. This way, and on this end here would be for a urinal, which would have a smaller spud, and then we have some other facets here for working on taking the handle apart and sorts, taking the bonnet off of a flushometer when that time comes to service it. So then basically it's long enough that it pretty much provides the proper amount of leverage that you need to service a valve. One of the other things, as far as fixed jaws go, that once you adjust them, that they maintain their opening, is that we're not compressing the coupling. And the key is, when you compress couplings, the control stop coupling, the handle coupling, the vacuum breaker coupling, and the spud coupling, if they squeeze, you're going to be grinding threads together. So this is one of the reasons why when you're using plier wrenches, especially say on a handle, you'll get what's called like a false tightening or loosening, where you're thinking that you're getting it tight, but what you wind up doing is you're squeezing the coupling so much that you actually start grinding the brass threads of the coupling against the brass threads of the valve body. And same thing applies with the control stop coupling here, where the tail secures to the valve body. Once you start squeezing this, it's going to give you this false tightening, or when you go to loosen it, you're going to be thinking this is overly tight, I can't get it because we're squeezing on it. So that's where the benefit of fixed jawed wrenches comes into play, because then we're grabbing it by the corners of the coupling when we go to tighten it or go to loosen it, and we're not putting any compressive force on the valve body. So you see here how this is nice and loose. If I were to take a typical plier wrench on there and I put a squeeze and loosen it, it gets real tight and you can't loosen it. So those are some of the tips that we're going to go over during the course of this whole general maintenance of the flushometer. Everything that we've learned over the years, we're going to pass on to you. So as far as using the right tools go, this is a quick example of what we're referring to as squeezing the brass. So this is a straight thread. This is nice and loose. And if you're using a fixed jawed wrench to work on this, it's going to loosen up as easy as it is with your hand. If I use a pair of pliers to grab a hold of this, I can actually hold this nice and steady and nothing's going to move. So this is what we were talking about. When you're squeezing it, because this is brass, it's soft that you can actually flex the coupling, and what you're going to wind up doing is grinding the threads of the coupling against the threads of the body. And same thing with the control stop coupling here to connect the valve body to control stop. Once you start squeezing, you're going to start grinding threads, and that's going to give you a false reading of how tight it is, or when you're going to loosen it, that you believe it to be tight when in fact you're squeezing the brass and grinding the threads together. So this example that we showed you of the proper tools is one of the reasons why we stress smooth jawed wrench. We offer our version, as well as there are several other type out there that they're adjustable smooth jawed, but they're fixed jawed, which means we're not squeezing once we adjust it to the proper dimension. And what that'll do is it'll definitely help you in servicing the fleshometer. So here we have laid out in front of us is an exploded or broken down view of all the components. We have the control stop. This is the exposed version. Here we have the concealed version. Then we have the valve body and the vacuum breaker assembly, as well as the handle and the spud coupling assembly. Inside the valve body, we have an inside cover, and then covered by the chrome cover, as well as the heart of the fleshometer, the diaphragm assembly. So the standard control stop, which is the H700 series, the only part that we're ever going to use any kind of pipe dope or thread will be on the male adapter that is protruding from the wall, or the supply stub out, and that is going to make the seal, because this is a pipe thread. So all the rest of the threads that we see on the valve body or on the control stop, all these threads that we see, these are all straight threads and these are mechanical threads. So there's going to be a gasket or an O-ring that is going to create the seal. On the control stop, inside we got the repair kit. So when the time comes that you have to service this, inside is your standard repair kit. This outside flange here and the material act as the gasket. So once it's installed and you tighten up the bonnet assembly, what you're going to do is put a squeeze on the bonnet, and that is going to tighten it up to the flange that is on the repair kit. And that's how that makes that seal. On the control stop, we have the threads. These are a coupling thread. We're just drawing two parts together. And on the valve body, you have an O-ring and the locking ring, and then the coupling. So when these two fit together, it's the O-ring that makes the seal. So we don't put any pipe dope or any pipe Teflon tape or sealant or both on any of these threads, because the way this is designed to work is you have a locking ring which binds into the bevel on the control stop, as well as on the inside of the coupling there's a bevel that matches to this locking ring. And when this comes together, we have a nice smooth bore on the inside of the control stop, and then the O-ring is what seals it. What holds it in place is this locking ring. Once we tighten this coupling up, what happens is we bind that locking ring, which is a stainless steel locking ring, and once we tighten that up, what you've done is you've squeezed that ring to dent itself into the tailpiece to hold its position. Now sometimes once you turn water on, it might be positioned in such a way where it slides out. So in that case, one little simple thing you can do is you turn the water back off, you hit the handle, hold the handle, push the valve back in place there to line it up, and then we get a hold of the locking ring and we spin it about a half a turn, put it back on, and then we're going to go ahead and tighten it up. And then when we turn the water on, the valve should stay steady. Once in a while, there's difficulty with the locking ring biting into its position, so that's one of the tips that we offer in order to make sure that the valve doesn't slide out, that it locks in its position. Once the valve shuts off and everything pressurizes, it locks and stays in its plumb position. Here we have a version of our Royal cutaway valve. And you'll see here that we have the control stop. And if you come up close, you'll see the main sealing part is when we tighten up this bonnet to the valve body, it makes the seal here. The second sealing part is the O-ring that's inside the cartridge. So this is the part that when we turn the screw, to turn the water on or off. That's what's sliding inside this sleeve. This is a cutaway, so this is the O-ring that is making the seal. Over time, this O-ring will take a set and compression, and it may stay that way for 10, 20 years or so, or when the time comes to work on the valve, as you turn this screw, you may be getting some water squirting past here. That's normal. However, when the time comes that you can't prevent this from dripping anymore, one little note that you can try is turning this stop screw inside and out. And so what that does is it sweeps this O-ring on the inside of the cartridge here of the kit, and sometimes there might be some scale that we're going to sweep clean. Part of the design of the control stop is a back check. When the valve finishes flushing, this back check engages. So if there's a negative pressure drop or a drop in pressure, that the valve will not enter into a run-on. So that's one of its three primary designs. The primary one is to turn the water on and off, as well as make your adjustment. That's a control stop necessity. Is this is why it's not a ball valve design, where it's not just on and off, that we actually control the flow because of different flushing pressures that you'll encounter depending on the size of the building, whether it's lots of floors or it's a very broad building where you have very long runs. So your flow pressures change, and during the course of that we're going to watch the toilet, but this is essentially how we control the flow, is how far open we're allowing this to open during the course of the flush. Next is the valve body assembly. So with the valve body, we have the hole through the body. This is where all the flushing water is going into your toilet or service sink or your urinal. And this is the two sealing areas. And then we have, again, coupling threads. And they mate with the cover. And in between there, we have the inner cover. Now, the outside edge of a diaphragm assembly acts as a gasket. So once this is installed and the inner cover is placed on here, this is putting a squeeze on the outside edge of the diaphragm. That's what prevents it from leaking. The old diaphragm wearing against this inside cover, what happens is it can embed itself or it can wear it, because the diaphragm is constantly moving up and down inside this inner cover. And what happens is that you can begin seeing some scoring here or some rubbing. If you have some pressure shocks in the system, you can develop some hairline cracks. And what you'll see is eventually is you'll see leaking coming down the outside of the cover. So when this is tight, and typically it's hand tight, and then you snug it with the wrench. And if you continue to see dripping coming from here, what happens is the diaphragm may no longer be sealing on the outside edge, or you may have developed a hairline crack. The way we fix this is we look at replacing the diaphragm as well as the inner cover, because these are the two parts that work together, not only for the diaphragm assembly, but to maintain a seal so we don't get any leaks. So here's an older inner cover that shows some score marks in there. And this is what happens over time of a diaphragm wearing itself into the inner cover. Now, the new design is black plastic versus the older design, which is a cream-colored plastic. So, and in that case here, the dimensions are all the same, but this is a good example of a worn-out inner cover. That's why it's a good idea to always change the inner cover when we're installing a new diaphragm assembly, because these two parts wear together, and they work together and they wear together. This is why it's a good idea that when you change the diaphragm assembly, we want to change the inner cover. One of the things we want to look at is when we're looking at the valve body is this top bore surface, and we want to make sure that there's no flaking chrome or any pitting, as well as this outside surface, if there's any flaking chrome or you may see pitting. In some cases, what you can do is take some very fine emery cloth, you dip it in some water, and you clean off the chrome here, and to make sure it's smooth. We don't want to necessarily grind any brass away, we just want to clean it till we got a smooth surface as well as this outside edge. So the first thing you could do is take like a scouring pad or something to clean off what's loose, or a brass bristled brush. We don't want to use anything outside of brass, because steel may begin to scratch it because it's stronger than the brass itself. So a brass bristled brush will keep it nice and clean, and then whatever's loose you can smoothen up with some very fine emery cloth with a little water. and then you wipe it clean, and as long as we feel a nice smooth surface. If you see any pits or chips in there, then it's time to change the valve body assembly. So here we have an example of a 65-year-old flushometer that we removed recently. It was working up until then, but they wanted to refinish the restrooms, so in doing so they removed the valves in place of some very nice chrome-plated clean ones. So what we're looking for here is we've seen signs of pipe dope. We've got a worn out, a wrong inner cover inside here because they had leaking that was going on. Here's a diaphragm, you can see some pipe dope, and what happens is it can get into the bypass hole of the diaphragm assembly. One other thing they ran into, what you see here on this edge is the old diaphragm assembly. Did you get that?
Yes, yes.
So what wound up happening is somebody that worked on it didn't realize that there was an old diaphragm assembly outside edge, which means when they pulled this apart, that diaphragm was so worn out that it just crumbled on them. So what happens is that sits too high, it's going to cause a way too long of a flush, and you're not engaging all the threads. As you can see here, all this pipe dope here wasn't even being used as a sign. Even though they use pipe dope, it shows you where it was engaging. So we only had a couple of threads actually holding the cover on there. And typically you want to bottom it out to at least the four threads there, so this way we know we got a tight seal. So now that we look at here, you can see, even though the chrome is worn away, we still have a nice smooth surface. This outside edge is a little rough, so what I'm going to do is take a little fine emery cloth, dip it in some water, and just clean it up until it's smooth again. It doesn't have to be perfect. The diaphragm will find its set in there, and there's enough squeeze on there that we're going to fill any small voids. Now, one of the things that on this older valve that was not correct, besides the pipe dope that's on here, is the wrong inner cover. The old style inner covers have a very long nipple on the top, and what that does is it bottoms out against the inside of the cover, and it's secured at two points. The thickness of this plastic mimics the old design of the brass inner covers. So the A11 was designed for these older bell-shaped covers. The A71 inside cover was designed for the current cover, and it may be stamped Royal, Regal, or you may see the word Sloan. You may see the word Royal 2. All these types use the A11. Here's a version of the Royal 2. You can see it's got a different shape, but internally the dimensions are the same. And that's what uses the A71 inner cover. And I'm going to go to a cutaway valve to show you why it's important. So here's the old style bell-shaped cover, and you'll see how the inner cover designed for it, the A11, bottoms out at the top of the inner cover as well as catching it on the outside edge all the way around for its outside squeeze to make a seal with the diaphragm assembly. So here you can see on this cutaway cover, you can see how it's bottoming out. If we were to use an A71 in there, you can see that we have no support on the top of it. What will eventually happen is this will split out. So on the A71 inner cover with the current valve, and these are current valve meaning that the current design since 1969, and you can see here on the cutaway, you could see that we're holding it in all three positions, where we're bracing it with the cover on the shoulder, on the top of the inner cover, as well as on the outside edge, maintaining the squeeze on the diaphragm for the seal. Now the A11 old style inner cover will not fit in here for obvious reasons. Its specific design is for the old style bell-shaped cover. The A11 is designed to fit inside there and properly maintain structural integrity in bracing it as well as a seal. Now with covers and inner covers, on the rare occasions that your installation may have a continental cover, as you can see it's got just a smooth low profile dome on there. Most of the times it'll be stamped continental, or some people put their own etching on there when the flushometer was ordered. But this uses its own inner cover, and this is known as the A71 Special. And it's actually molded on the inner cover, it says Special A71. And then, as you see, this has no nipple on the top, but it's braced against the top and the shoulders and the outside edge for these style of inner covers. So now we move on to the handle assembly. The handle assembly is the important part of activating a flush. And what that does is it trips the relief valve that's on the diaphragm assembly. The handle is coming in, puts a tilt on it, and then begins your flush, and then the diaphragm lifts inside the valve body, and then it comes back down to shut off. And then with the integrated parts of the diaphragm assembly, this is what's controlling part of your volume as well as how quickly it shuts off. So the reason why this is an integral part and a very important part is a handle does wear out. And there's two forms of wearing out. One is leaking, and two places that it's going to leak. If it begins to leak from the coupling, that tells you that the gasket, when it's new, you may not have put enough squeeze on the coupling assembly, and it means that the gasket is not providing a seal. If it leaks from the knuckle, that tells you that inside the handle assembly, the seal has worn out, and water is beginning to pass by the plunger assembly. And sometimes you may find a push button on the front of your valve, and you'll see that it also has a seal on there. We have two different types. We've got the B50A, which has been around for a long number of years, going back over 50 years. And it's, you'll see that when it's a B50A, the bushing is white, and you'll see it's got the plunger and spring, and you got the cone seal, and this fits and snaps over the barb, and then we have the gasket for the side of the valve body. One tip that I suggest is using 100% silicone grease, whereas what you'll do is you'll take your grease, you'll put a little dab on the inside of the seal and a little bit on the outside here and a little on the plunger. And make sure it's 100% silicone grease, because any petroleum-based grease, what it'll do is it'll begin deteriorating the seal. So once we greased it up and we put this on there, you'll feel it snap over, give it a little spin to make sure it's over the barb, and just wipe off any excess on the outside. And what that'll do is it'll have a little lubricant inside and extend the life of your B50A kit. Then we move into the Royal Handle Repair Kit assembly. And what this is it's got an added feature to it. Inside this cone seal, as you can see, it's got a bump in. Inside there is a groove. And inside that groove, you'll see that we have silicone grease already pre-installed. And inside, though, there's actually two grooves inside there, and that holds grease and maintains a seal on the inside. We have a second handle repair kit, and this one here, it comes pre-assembled. This is the B51A. And you'll see it's got the same spring, the same plunger. Instead of white, it has a black bushing and the handle kit, but the important part of it is the seal. The main component is the seal. You'll see this comes pre-assembled. The reason being is we pre-grease it on the inside of the plunger. And that's the reason why you see this bump, is because there's a groove in there holding the grease. And so what happens is it's a pocket of grease that is constantly keeping the plunger lubricated as it goes in and out. And what that does is it slightly greases the other end of the cone seal, and this maintains lubricity on there, so it extends the life of the plunger with the handle. This is what we replace when the handle is leaking. One of the other things about the handle that we have to pay attention to is, as a valve gets older, and especially when it's a standard height flushometer, and unfortunately people do kick it with their feet all the time, and what can happen is the handle itself can wear out. So, and you'll notice that in the flush itself, where the flush is not the same between flushes. From flush to flush, what you'll see is that the flush is shorter sometimes, or sometimes it seems like it's a partial flush. So whether the handle is the current Royal style handle, the B73A handle assembly, or the older style, which is the B32 handle assembly, they do wear out. And in the case of an older flushometer, you'll see the old style B32 handle assembly. When these have been around a while, and you can see this one's had signs of leaking because you can see the scale buildup on there. But what can happen over the years, and whether it's the newer style B32 or the B73A or this older style one, so what you can see over the years is we have to look at the handle, and what contributes that is erratic flushing. So we're going to take the handle assembly apart, and we're going to get down to the handle, and what we could see here is a groove has worn itself into the handle. What happens is inside that groove is actually grabbing the end of the plunger and lifting on it. Normally when you push the handle, it forces its way outward. Over time, that groove can develop, and that actually picks up on the plunger and it tilts it downward, so it's going to wear the bushing, the hole through the bushing, as well as the lower that the plunger tilts down during the course of extending it when you push down on the handle. The lower this is, the lower it is hitting the relief valve on the diaphragm assembly. And what that contributes to is it's going to give you a shorter flush. So the handle would be replaced in this case because it does wear out. And so you would pick up a B73A handle. While you're at it, the difference between the B73A and the B32A is the B73A automatically comes with the better seal on the cone seal on the handle, as well as you can see it's a little longer and it's ADA compliant, whereas the B32A is not ADA compliant. It's not long enough, requires more leverage, and it's a direct replacement from the old style B32. So you happen to have a concealed valve which sits behind a wall, or you have to cut through an access panel, you're going to have the C9A, which will be a button assembly, or you're going to have the B12A, which is the handle assembly protruding through the wall. So on the front of the panel, you may see the wall box version. This one has a hex on there, which utilizes a little set screw that we're going to loosen. And once we loosen this, we take this flange off. And then this gives us access to removing the wall plate or the wall panel that you'll have on your wall box. And so this is what will be sitting out. Then you remove the panel, and then you have your handle assembly. The back end of the handle assembly, just like on a concealed valve, you'll see they both come to the same components. Now on a concealed valve, the bushing is brass. It is not plastic. So we don't use a B51 or B50A handle repair kit on them because it's plastic, and there's two things about it. One, showing you the B51A, you can see that the flange is half of the thickness. What that's going to do is bring this closer, and inside the valve body, the relief valve may set on top of it because you're bringing it too close. So the reason that is as thick as it is so this way it brings it further away from the relief valve. So that way when it's pushing, or when the valve shuts off, it doesn't rest on it, it comes back in place in front of it. Now on these type of designs here, where they'll leak from is around the knuckle. And when they leak around the knuckle, or in the case of a push button when it's flushing, that means the seal has gone out. And so what we do is we replace it with the concealed repair kit. And this is the C77A. We offer the C70A, which is a common one, but you'll see that that one has the standard seal that you find on the B32A. So it's not going to last as long, but when you do put it together, you can slap a little grease on the inside of it, make sure it's 100% silicone grease, and that'll extend the life. Or you can get the C77A, and this way you're going to get it pre-assembled with the pre-greased higher quality cone seal. And this is what we're going to replace on the valve body here with the current one. We don't use the plastic one. We use the C70A or the C77A. We prefer the C77A. It'll get you further life expectancy out of the handle assembly. Vacuum breaker tube, and the reason it's a vacuum breaker tube, besides being flanged, is it has vent holes punched into the top of the tube. And the way it works is we have a vacuum breaker, and it's a flexible sack. And the way this works is once it's installed, and without the coupling in the way there, it sits like this. And the tube sits over it. And the way this works is during the course of the flush, water will expand this. And being that it's still a tight fit, what it does is it seals itself to the inside of the holes during the flush. So water is going to exit through the slit in the bottom. This will expand. And as it's flushing, water is flowing into the toilet or the urinal. And at the end of the flush, as the valve slowly closes off, the sac relaxes, and then air is drawn through as the siphon creates a suction, finishing off the rest of the water, which is replenishing the water spot. And so this is required by code. And if you look close enough, stamped on the vacuum breaker assembly, you could see this CL, which stands for critical level. And this line can't be any shorter than 6 inches to the top of the toilet, because that's considered the flood rim level. And so when you're installing one, by code, you can't be any less than 6 inches to the top of the toilet. Sloan offers two types of vacuum breakers assembly. The tube is the same, whether it is the V500A or V500AA, the A being the short one with a male slip joint adapter swaged to the bottom of the tube, and then the standard vacuum breaker tube. And whether it's a V500AA or a V600AA, the tube is the same. What you'll see is two different couplings. One coupling you'll see, they're both the same height, but what you'll see is this skirt here and the hex is on the top. And this will come standard on the V500A. And the V600A uses a one-piece machined coupling, and it still has the skirt on the bottom end, but the hex is on the bottom end. And what that does is it gives you a little bit more clearance on the bottom of the valve when you have a handle on there and you're turning a wrench. That'll give you a little bit more clearance away from the handle, so you're not going to be scraping your knuckles or anything like that. And so the other difference is when you have a V500A, it comes standard with the V551A vacuum breaker kit inside. And you can see the difference between the V500A and the V600A vacuum breakers. The V551A vacuum breaker kit, that's the name of the repair kit, and the V651A vacuum breaker repair kit. This has an extended skirt on there. They both have the bevel, but what this does is it allows more surface adherence during the flush because of high efficiency toilets, 1.28 and 1.6. What they do is they create a little bit more back pressure. So this sac here energizes a little quicker and gives you more surface adhesion to prevent that little bit of spill of water at the end of the flush. They're interchangeable as a repair kit. And when asked, you know, which one do you prefer? I said, well, being that they're interchangeable, I always suggest the V651A as a repair kit. If you're going to purchase the vacuum breaker tube assembly, then you would use the V600AA vacuum breaker assembly. So you'll get the benefits of the coupling with the hex on the bottom, as well as the extended skirt, the high back pressure skirt there on the vacuum breaker assembly. One little note on the vacuum breaker repair kits, whether it be the V551A or the V651A kit, you'll notice there was a change in the baffle on the inside. The reason being is we redesigned the baffle to allow more water to flow through there, because the higher efficiency toilets there, this can have slightly more restriction than this design. So we switched over recently to this design, maybe a few years ago. And so this was the long standard design here for approximately 50 years, and we moved over to this design there to allow more flow for high efficiency toilets. They're equal in performance. You won't see any effect on the difference of performance or anything, except for the fact that it allows a little bit more water during the course of the flush. Both parts work equally well, except this allows a little bit more volume during the course of the gallons per flush on the flush. It doesn't increase the volume itself. What it does is it increases the flow during the course of the flush. So whether using the V551A vacuum breaker assembly or the V651A vacuum breaker assembly, the standard is, when this is a repair, the first thing we want to do is we want to make sure that the inside diameter of the tube, usually you want to look at the first few inches in there, first 2 to 3 inches, you want to make sure it's smooth. Over time, you'll get scale buildup on the inside, and what happens is, here's an example of an old one here. You'll get some scale buildup, and it'll work its way up over time, and then you'll see some dripping. And typically the way that works is at the end of the flush, you might see a little drip or spill of water. Now, This is aside from multiple flushing, which is something we don't do to test a vacuum breaker. You want to wait till all the water drains from the tube and the toilet and the water spot settles, and then you flush again. And if you see a drip, that tells you this is time to change the vacuum breaker assembly. This one, of course, has outlived its usefulness. And one other thing that I want to show you on this is you see how it's curled over. This is because somebody over-tightened it. It's possible that what happened was it started dripping and they figured that the coupling was loose, so they over-tightened it. And by doing that, what they wound up doing is they smashed the outside edge of the seal of the vacuum breaker around the vacuum breaker baffle. So this is a big no-no. Usually it's hand-tightened with a slight snug. And so once we clean this up, and if you find some buildup in scale, use a coarse rag or scouring pad to see what you can break up. If it's so embedded that you can't get it out of there, then I would advise replacing the vacuum breaker assembly, buying the whole V600AA or V500AA. So you'll get a brand new tube along with the new kit and sorts. But if it's relatively on the new side, and that can be anywhere between the last 10, 20 years, what we do is we take a fine emery cloth and we can scrub it clean. If it breaks apart clean and then you put a nice polish back on there, then we're good to go. We don't want to use anything coarse because as you grind the brass away, you're going to leave heavy scratches which can wick water past there. So we want to keep it nice and smooth on the inside. This is why we use a very fine emery cloth to clean it up or a scouring pad to see what we can break free. We don't have to do the whole tube. We're only talking about the adhesion side or the adhesion surface where the vacuum breaker lays. So when installing the vacuum breaker assembly, once you install the kit, and this is after the tube has been cleaned out, we have our fiber gasket or our friction ring. Now oftentimes what happens is once you install this and put this on here and you tighten it up on the valve, and again we hand tighten it, and then we're just going to take our wrench and we're going to just snug it up. That's all that's needed, because if you look at the thickness of this and the pliability of it, it doesn't take a whole lot to put a nice squeeze on there. When it's inside of a coupling, it's captive, so it's not going to mash outward, but if you over tighten it, you will wind up either cracking or forcing this baffle to bend inward and create a gap. This is why it's hand tighten and snug it with a wrench. So what happens is you turn the water on now, and the fiber gasket has not soaked up the water yet to fatten up and fill any voids that might be on the, between the bottom of the valve body and the top of the vacuum breaker. So what you'll see is water will drip from above. And the first instance you're thinking is, oh, it's not tight enough. Well, that's not the case. It is tight enough. What happens is this fiber gasket has not swelled or filled any slight void. So what I always advise is to wet the fiber gasket first. Before you install it, dip it in a little bit of water and let it start fattening up with soaking up the water, and then go ahead and install it. One other tip that you can do is you can take some silicone grease, 100% silicone grease, and do a thin swipe on the bottom of the valve body. You can forego the ring. It's not standard plumbing practice, but the whole point of this is to prevent this from grinding anything. But if you hold the tube steady while you tighten it, you're not going to grind it. But the grease, the 100% silicone grease, will make a little barrier to prevent the rubber from melting into the bottom of the valve body. And so you can put a little thin swipe of silicone grease, nothing major. And again, these threads are a straight thread. They're a coupling thread or a mechanical thread. They are just drawing the tube to the bottom of the valve body and putting a proper squeeze on the top of the vacuum breaker sack, which acts as a gasket. And so what we do is, once we tighten this up, and again, all you really need to do is hand tighten it, and then we take our wrench and we put a little snug on there, and that should be more than enough. And then we turn our water back on, and then we check. So again, we can't emphasize enough. We don't want to put any Teflon tape or any pipe dope or pipe sealant on the threads, because these threads are not a sealing thread. The only sealing threads on the valve body are on the stop. When we install it, we put the threads on the sealant on the male thread, and we tighten up the stop, and that's it. We assemble this tail into the body, and that's also a 1-inch pipe thread in here, but we pre-seal it and we pre-install it, and then we test it to make sure that it doesn't leak. Other than that, everything is either a gasket or an O-ring, so we should not see any pipe dope or Teflon tape or any type of sealant applied to any of the connections, whether it's the cover, the handle, the control stop coupling, the bonnet on the control stop, as well as the vacuum breaker, and we'll get to the spud here in a second. So, but on this, again, hand tighten, slightly snug it. If you do over tighten it, you will damage the sack, you will distort the sack, and that can cause dripping at the flush. And the only time we want to worry about replacing the sack is when you begin to see the dripping. And that can take years before you see it develop, depending on your water quality and the frequency of use. So the vacuum breaker, if you have any issues with the flushing going on, that's usually the diaphragm or if with the handle. But as long as we don't see any dripping on the vacuum breaker at the end of the flush, we do not change the vacuum breaker sack until it's time or required or part of your general preventative maintenance schedule on flushometers. So in this part here, we have the spud, which you'll find this in the top of a urinal or a service sink in a water closet. And what this is fitted into the toilet, and this is part of the toilet. It is not part of the flushometer. We offer one as a replacement part, the ST27A. And basically the way the spud works is the gasket fits inside the hole, and as you tighten this up, the wedge expands this to the inside diameter of the hole. So the top surface of the toilet will be the bottom of this gasket. And the way it works here is the escutcheon or the spud flange covers the brass, and it's a beauty ring, and you'll see where the top of the spud comes up close to the top of the flange. And what happens is we have a spud coupling for the flange, and you'll see the it's only got a small hex at the top, and the reason being is not every toilet is designed exactly the same, so this allows for different heights of the spuds depending on the thickness of the toilet or the urinal and sorts like that. And what happens is if it's on the high end, it'll still create wedging in there, so we have our nice beauty ring covering up the brass. Or if it's on the low end, this will be able to slide all the way down and still make contact. So on the inside, the way this works is we have a slip joint gasket and our friction ring. And what this does is it seals to the spud. So when the vacuum breaker is installed, get in our friction ring. And this coupling acts just like all the other couplings. It's drawing the brass spud to the tube and putting a squeeze on that gasket and fattening it up to make a seal. So once this is installed and we tighten it up and we put a good squeeze on there, we don't want to over tighten it because you may start spinning the spud, but then we tighten that up and that creates our seal between the tube and the spud. So that is the general maintenance of a flushometer and some of the symptoms and some of the things to look for when servicing it, plus some tips that we share along. So if you need more information, you can call us at 1-888-756-2614 or Sloan14. It's 888-Sloan14. You can also go to sloan.com for technical information as well as our maintenance guides and sorts. And that's it in a nutshell. I'm Dominic with Sloan Technical Support. Thanks for spending time.